सो नमस्ते. सो फार वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट हार्मनी इन द फैमिली एंड द नेक्स्ट लेवल ऑफ आवर लिविंग इज सोसाइटी. सो विल नाउ एक्सप्लोर इनटू अंडरस्टैंडिंग द हार्मनी इन द सोसाइटी. राइट. सो एंड द प्रोसेस इज द सेम दैट वी हैव बीन गोइंग थ्रू दिस प्रोसेस ऑफ सेल्फ एक्सप्लोरेशन. यू नो टेकिंग व्हाट एवर इज सेड इज अ प्रपोजल एंड देन verifying on one's own right and then also trying to live accordingly. So we saw that family is the basic unit or building block of human organization and society is the next larger order. Society is composed of many families living together, making collective effort for a common goal. So we are a part of the society anyway, isn't it? So in this session, we are going to explore about goal of the human being living in a society, the dimensions or systems required to achieve the human goal, and the scope of the systems. So one thing that is mentioned here is a common goal. So one thing to explore is, in a society, while living together, can we all have a common goal? Unless we have a common goal and we are living together, can we have mutual fulfillment? Can we have mutual happiness? Right? So this is again something to be explored. If we have conflicting goals, then what will happen? So there are three possibilities. One possibility is family living together in a relationship of mutual fulfillment, having a common goal. The second possibility is people living together, but not in a relationship of mutual fulfillment, having differing goals. And the third possibility is people living separately, right, in a position or a struggle and having conflicting goals. Now just try to imagine, you know, the three states. So we'll have some reflection from you on this. So what is desirable? The first one, the second one, or the third one? And where are we today? First one or the second one or the third one? So we have families living in our neighborhood, and we are living in a colony. That colony is again having a neighboring colony, and so on and so forth, right? We make a district, so we make a state, we make a nation, we make the whole world. So if you look at the three possibilities, you know, one possibility is that all of us have a common goal and then we can work together. We can be complementary to each other. The other possibility is that we are not concerned, we are not bothered about the other. Now, if you see the way the apartments are getting populated, the way we are living in the cities, right, we are hardly aware what is happening in our neighborhood. So we may have differing goals, you know, unconcerned about each other. And the third possibility is that we are having conflicting goals. So if I go to fulfill my goal, you know, the other is going to be defeated. And if the other is going to fulfill his goal, my goal is going to be defeated. You know? So just find out what is naturally acceptable first one, you know, or the second one, or the third one, and where are we today? If there is any question regarding this, then I can take up. Okay, nice. Any sharing or any comment on this from any of the participants? Okay. Dr. Radhakrishnan?
Yeah, very good afternoon, Dr. Kumar. It's a very good opportunity to discuss about the three things. One is, you know, the families are living together in relationship with the mutual fulfillment. The other one, you know, the families living together in a relationship of the mutual fulfillment.
Not in a relationship, yeah. Not in a relationship, yes.
Yeah, not in a relationship. The third one, you know, it is a little different. So I think the question is really, it is a very odd question. And of course, you know, it's all relating to three generations. So I'm living in the present generation. So mostly,
If you look at the evaluation, there's some sound coming from the background, sir. If you look at the current situation, we are able to see that we are not able to live. And as people are also reflecting, we are not able to live with a feeling of mutual fulfillment.
Yeah, the first one, you know, it's my forefathers. I mean, my parents, they lived. The second is in my, and third, of course, is my children. They are going to live in that third category.
We'll talk about it, sir. In this session only, we'll talk about it. What is happening?
Really, it is interesting. And we have to take some measures in this regard. Living together is really, it is a very, very, you know, it creates a very kind of, you know, the relationship and very useful to us. But most of the people, depending upon their desires and understanding level, it is very, 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 you know, it is difficult. Even, you know, sorry to say this, even in my wife and my, you know, the mother, is they're not having a good relationship. So obviously we are separated. I'm living in separate and my mother is living in a separate. This is what the condition. So the people should understand this and we have to take some measures.
Very nice. Happy to see that you made such an honest and sincere sharing. So very nice, sir. This might be happening in so many families and we are suffering account.
Of course, sir. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thanks, sir. So nice. So most of us are able to see very easily that we want to have family living together in a relationship of mutual fulfillment, right? And if you evaluate the current state, there is a very low possibility that people are living together with a relationship of fulfillment, but rather, you know, we are not having that kind of relationship. But we are, we can see this gap and we aspire for mutual fulfillment with everybody, but this is not the current state. You know? And we also can see that people are in opposition, right, many a times. So if you look at the first possibility, then we can term it as a society. Society would mean that we are having a relationship of mutual fulfillment. The second possibility is crowd. We are just moving here and there. Nobody is concerned about the other. We have differing goals. And the third possibility, if you see, it is a battlefield. Now you can see how much money we are investing, resources we are investing today, you know, in the name of war or, you know, to settle the internal feuds, right? And if you look at the family also, many times the family also becomes a battlefield. So we'll explore harmony in the society. The base of harmony in society is harmony in the family, for which the base is harmony in the human being. So we started building up this understanding by exploring the harmony in the human being. Then we discussed about harmony in the family. And now we are going to discuss harmony in the society. But one thing is for sure, that if a person himself or herself is not in harmony, he cannot participate in the harmony in the family. And if the family is not in harmony, the family cannot participate in the harmony of the society. So if you look at the common goal, what can be the common goal while living together? So certain things are listed here. I'll go over them one by one and you start thinking whether this can be a common goal. So can it be possible that every individual has right understanding and right feeling? So once we have right understanding and right feeling, then it ensures happiness. Right? So is this desirable or not? Let us think about it. It is desirable that every human being has the right understanding, right feeling. Can this be a goal, a common goal of the society? Then every family, let it be prosperous. Prosperity in every family. This is second coveted, you know, state that you'd like to go for. Thirdly, fearlessness, that is at least a feeling of trust in the society for all. And the fourth possibility, the fourth thing that we'd like to go for is coexistence, mutual fulfillment in the nature. So when we are making our goals in life, many times we are not able to take into account, you know, these things. So can we have this kind of goal in the society? One thing. Second thing, once we have this kind of goal, then only it can be a common goal. Otherwise, if you continue to be conflicting goal or unrelated goal, isn't it? So what we are proposing here, that while living in a society, you know, every human being can have this kind of goal, and that's why it is called human goal. So are all four required, desirable, or we can leave something out? Think over this, you know, explore this. Can we drop something from here? Like, can we say that no need for right understanding, right feeling, only we have to work for prosperity? Or can it be that, okay, you know, individual has the right understanding, family has the prosperity, that is enough why to go for fearlessness in the society. Or we can say that, you know, okay, human beings are fine, you know, why to bother about rest of the nature. So you can see, you know, that all four are required, you know, desire. But again, let us take some reflection from you. And if all four are achieved, what would anything else be required? And are we working for all the four in the family, in the society? So where do we start from? Right. So first of all, find out whether all four are required, all four are desirable, you know, or we can leave something out. And also see if all these four are achieved, then what else would be required as a society? Is there something which is left out? This is one part. Secondly, we can see that whether we are working for all the four in the family, in the society, or we are working only for some component or even not a single component. And next we can see that where do we have to start from? So let me take some reflection from you here. Pause a little bit, Anna, explore and then respond to this. The same questions put up here. In the meantime, if there is any question, I can take up. So Dr. Uma Rani has raised her hand. Okay. Dr. Uma Rani, anything pertaining this? Dr. Helen? Dr. Helen?
Hello, sir. Hello. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Hope I'm audible.
Yeah, ma'am.
So in the previous slide, you have mentioned some points regarding this disagreement in the family. Persons are having different goals and they are within the family.
Mm-hmm.
And I need to be clarified regarding the current trends. Nowadays, the youngsters are having the idea of having living together.
Mm-hmm.
And why is this kind of attitude raised particularly in foreign countries?
You're talking about the living relationships?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Living togetherness. Okay.
Yeah. So that is.
Okay. That is, they are not ready to be married like that. I'm not much clear about that.
Yeah. In fact, let me share one thing. That one pair came to us, you know, when we were having one workshop at Hyderabad, and they were trying to justify this live-in relationship. And then we simply asked them, "What is the problem in committing?" And then they had no answer. So it so happens, no, that if you are not accepting the relationship, you are not ready to commit.
But might still, be due to lack of trust like that.
Yeah, certainly, ma'am. And another possibility, if I go ahead, can be just trying to ensure happiness in the conjugal relationship out of sensation. And then picking and dropping the relationships.
Yes, sir.
And this kind of trend, if you see, you know, it is not going to lead to a harmonious society at all. Right? It is not going to ensure happiness in the individual also, on either side.
Sir, we are much worried about the future because nowadays the youngsters are preferring.
Certainly, ma'am, and this trend is growing in the metro cities. This trend is growing in the metro cities.
Yes.
Yeah, and certainly this is not a healthy thing that is happening in the society. So we have to strengthen our education. We have to strengthen our education. This kind of understanding has to become an essential component, because students, if you see, they have the same natural acceptance. They have the potential to understand. And they can also understand through this kind of program. Only thing is that we are not taking the right content to them. And they are influenced by movies. You know? If you look at the movies today, you know,
yes,
if you look
obvious.
At 50 years back, right? The actor, the lead actor used to have one kind of relationship. The lead actor today has a different kind of relationship, which is, you know. So they are getting misled through movies, through media, you know, through news, which is, you know, roaming around, right? So our students are getting preconditioned. Our students are getting preconditioned.
Yes, sir.
And as an educator, it is our role to help them explore so that they are able to live according to their natural acceptance in place of going by their preconditioning.
Exactly, sir. That is what I need for our students. How to put light on this in a very clear manner. This is not recommendable or advisable, and they are going to
So prescription will not help, ma'am. Prescription will never help. If you just say that this is wrong and that is right, they will have some reactive questions, right?
Yes, sir.
So this prescription will never help. Only that you have to ask the right questions. That why do you want to go for the other party, other person? You know, is it for sensation? Is it out of some preconditioning? When we are talking about the feeling of love, you know, we saw that so many preconditionings are there, you know, ruling the imagination of the young people, you know, and that's why so many crimes are also taking place. So we can ask the right question that
and one more
has been made through natural acceptance or sensation or preconditioning.
And nowadays, in few of the advertisements also, we are coming across this aspect.
Certainly, certainly the media is helping it out. You know? But again, if you look at the media people also, you know, they have a kind of goal that they have to increase their TRP or they have to, you know, become the winner in the market, and that's why they are doing. But they are also, if you see, the natural acceptance is pure. Only that they have also got preconditioned in one way. So all of us living in a society are preconditioned in multiple ways. And with lack of right understanding, we have got conflicting goals. And sometimes these conflicting goals, or many times these conflicting goals, you know, raise the exploitation of society, raise the deprivation of society.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, thanks. Nice. So, one minute, I'll just mute.
Hello?
1 minute. So we can see that, you know, most of us are able to see that all the four goals are required, they are desirable. You know? No need to leave anything out of this. And if all four are achieved, would anything else be required? So many of us are able to see that, yes. But if you feel that something, you know, else is required, then let us explore into it. Or maybe as we go ahead, the meanings of these words will become better clear. Right? And are we working for all the four? So, you know, many of you say that, yes, we are working, but we'll explore this further, whether we are working for this or not. And where do we start from? So most of us are able to see that, yes, it has to start from the individual. Very nice. So we have to start from the individual. Unless I have the right understanding in me, how can I ever have the feeling of prosperity in me? How can I ever have the feeling of trust for the other? How can I ever be mutually fulfilling to the other? And when the individual has the right understanding, then only the family can have the feeling of prosperity. So when we are saying prosperity in every family, it does not mean that excluding right understanding. So it means right understanding as well as prosperity in every family. So every individual in the family has the right understanding. Along with the family has a feeling of prosperity. You know? And prosperity is put at the level of family, because while living in a family only, we are able to work together to fulfill the needs of the family. There may be some member in the family, like a small child, who is not able to go and produce, or an old person who is not able to go and produce. So this prosperity is attained at the level of family. Similarly, at the level of society, we can have fearlessness, you know, no fear. You can see that how much we are investing today in the name of fear. At the level of a village, at the level of a district, at the level of a state, at the level of nation, you know, so many times we are threatened, and that's why we have to invest so much of physical facility out of fear. And once people are able to live together with mutual happiness, mutual prosperity, then only we can be mutually fulfilling with the rest of nature also. Otherwise, whatever we do for the nature, if the people are not in harmony living together, they will go and undo whatever we have done for the nature. So the right way to proceed would be like this. Very nice. But if you look at what is happening today, no, this is the state of gross misunderstanding. So one common misunderstanding today is that money is everything. You know, this kind of assumption has gone into the imagination of the people, that money is everything, right? And when you try to have this, you know, or when you evaluate this kind of conditioning for every individual, then you can see so many obsessions come up. Like there is one obsession for consumption, right? There is a common saying among the students that earn enough to spend enough to earn enough. Now this is obsession for consumption, how much to consume. We can see when we're talking about health that many people are becoming unhealthy out of overconsumption of food, right? Obesity has become a common problem. If you look at most of the problems, you know, it is certainly to do with the lack of right understanding, and at the same time, consuming something which is either not required, you know, like consuming more than what is required, or something which is not required, right? So there may be obsession for consumption. There is one story about this ruler of Rome about 400 to 500 years back. whose name was Nero, and it is said that he was so fond of consuming food that he would have cooks in his palace, and they will prepare delicious food, and he will consume the food, and then he will again vomit and then consume back, right? Consume some more food. So this kind of trend, if you look at it, appears to be quite humorous. But ultimately, when we are not having the right understanding and we are trying to derive happiness out of physical facility, this kind of obsession can emerge. Obsession for consumption, obsession for sensual pleasure. You know, trying to derive sensation out of taste or out of sound or out of sight or out of touch or smell. You know, we can see so many things. Like we had shared one video of a story of stuff. If you look at the example that are being sent, shared there, so they denote the obsession which is taking place today. And then there can be obsession of profit. So how much to make as a profit? So earlier, one motivation was to have profit. Then the motivation converted into, it's not only good for good to go for profit, but rather the profit should also increase day by day, year by year. So there has the rate of increase of profit has to be positive. And another trend has come that it's not only the rate of increase of profit, the rate of increase of profit, that has to be maximized. So this kind of obsession can emerge in the society when people are not having the right understanding. Similarly, if you look at the family, people are obsessed with accumulation by any means, and that also trying to make it unlimited. And if you see, not every family can accumulate by any means, right? So it can only be possible for few individuals, and that will always lead to a struggle in the society. So when people are having this kind of assumption that money is everything and they are trying to accumulate by any means, so what is resulting in the society is domination, exploitation, fear, right? And an extreme of this is problems like terrorism and war. And similarly, in place of coexisting with the nature, we might have been trying to master over the nature, exploit the nature. So the river is flowing in one way and we feel that it is not going the right way. So we have to mend the path of the river. The tree is not growing the right way. We have to mend the growth of the tree. And we might also conduct researches on this, right? But ultimately, when you go to master over the nature, exploit the nature, we are going to suffer. And we can see that there are so many problems like resource depletion, pollution. There is one scientist named Stephen Hawking. He died 2 years back and he came to India about, say, 10 or 12 years back. And then when he came to India, people asked him that, what do you see as the major challenges in front of humanity today? So he named 5 major challenges, like one, resource depletion, pollution, then nuclear warfare, biological warfare, global warming, like these major challenges he named. Then people said that, okay, you have named so many challenges and of course they are challenging. What do you see as a solution? What can a scientist do or a technological group do to undo these kinds of problems? So after some thought, he said that what we can do is only this, that we can conduct so much of research that we leave this planet and go to some other planet. Now just think, can this ever be a solution? If we have made this earth into this kind of state, with pollution, resource depletion, when we go to some other planet, what will you do, right? And with so much of technological advancement, situation may become worse. So if you look at the current state of the society, we have landed somewhere here. And this is certainly not acceptable naturally. So what our natural acceptance is, if you see, to have this human goal being fulfilled as a society. That understanding and right feeling in every individual, prosperity in every family, fearless in the society, coexistence in nature and existence. But out of preconditionings or obsessions with sensations, we are doing something like this. And this is certainly not desirable, and we all are suffering. We can see that we are locked up in our houses, only because of these kinds of obsessions. And ultimately, we are going to suffer. Now, when you go to fulfill this human goal, then what programs would you make? So 5 kinds of programs can be opted for. Like one program is education sanskar. The second program can be health and self-regulation. The third program can be production and work. Fourth program can be justice and preservation. And the fifth program can be exchange and storage. So these programs are basically the systems or dimensions of human order. So while working for these 4 goals, we need to work on each of these programs. and we can see how this human goal is going to be fulfilled. For example, when we are going to have education which is focused on right understanding, then this first goal will fulfill. And then the sanskar that will evolve in the students, you know, will enable them to lead a life of happiness and prosperity. With a feeling of self-regulation, ensuring health in the body, we can ensure prosperity in the family, isn't it? You know? And for prosperity, you also need to do production. So production means that I work on the rest of nature, and from there I get some produce. And through that produce, I'm able to ensure prosperity in my family. Again, to ensure fearlessness in the society, I need to work for justice. Justice would mean, as we discussed earlier, to develop that kind of competence in the self so that we are able to contemplate, understand, you know, the nine feelings, and we are able to live accordingly so that we are able to live with mutual happiness. And the mark of justice is mutual happiness. And also for preservation, if you see, preservation would mean that we are able to enrich the nature, we are able to protect the nature, you know, we are able to rightly utilize the nature. So through that, we can be coexisting with the nature. And when we are working for health and self-regulation, there also, you know, it indirectly helps us to coexist with the nature. Because when our production processes are in keeping with the harmony in the nature, then only that production process can be sustainable. Similarly, not that everybody will be producing everything. So we have to have exchange. You know? Now, when you go to ensure exchange rightly in the society, then we are able to ensure mutual prosperity. So every family can be prosperous when we have the right kind of exchange happening in society, free of exploitation, you know, free of corruption or all those things which are malpractices. Right? And similarly, we need to have a program of storage also. Storage means that we may not be able to produce everything every time. For example, this is the summer season and like paddy would be coming up. And then paddy would not be coming up during the winter. So what we can do, we can store the paddy so that we are able to have rice to eat throughout the year. So in a similar manner, we can store whatever we produce for our future use and also to share with the other. So when we have these kinds of programs, then we are able to fulfill the human goal. And here we need to reflect on the system that would enable this kind of program. So we all are a part of education system. So we have to start thinking what we need to do in education so that the human goal is fulfilled, right? So we understood that the content of education is to understand harmony at all levels, you know? But when we take it as a course and we try to make the whole content of education, you know, value-based, then we have to work a lot. So right from primary education to the higher education, we have to evolve that kind of content. And so much of creativity would be involved there. But the base would be to ensure the right understanding. So we have to start thinking whether it is an engineering program or a pharmacy or architecture or medicine, whatever. You know, how can that education ensure the right understanding in the person? You know, how can it ensure the sanskar? So if you look at all these systems, the foundational system is education and sanskar. In terms of health and self-regulation also, you know, we have to think proactively. Presently, our hospitals or health centers are focused on curing diseases. Now, this is not the right kind of program, cure the diseases. So when we go to work in the society or even at a personal level, there can be three kinds of programs. One kind of program is being reactive. Something happens to us and we react to it. The second kind of program could be, you know, active. When something happens to us, we start thinking in terms of right understanding and try to do something actively. And the third kind of program is proactive. Proactive would mean that we know that if you do not have the right understanding, you know, something unexpected or something, you know, undesirable is going to happen, and then we work for it proactively. So a complete kind of transformation will take place in the dimension of the society when we are working for right understanding. So the role of doctor would not be merely to cure the disease. Of course, if somebody is coming with a disease, he will be cured. But a proactive role would be to ensure the self-regulation in every family, in every human being, to educate the person so that one is able to take care of the health. You know? Similarly, like in education, our role will not be limited to inculcating only some skills. Right, our role would be to ensure the right understanding. Similarly, for production, you know, we'll not focus on extracting the maximum from the nature, you know, and consuming it, rather we'll focus on fulfilling our need correctly. And when you go to produce, there are two major questions to address. One is what to produce and the other is how to produce. So what to produce gets decided through our right understanding. When I'm able to see that the physical facility is required only for the nurturing, protection and right utilization of the body. And for that, I have to work with the rest of nature. So what to produce is decided with right understanding. Now how to produce, when you go to respond, then you have to understand the nature. If I have to produce food, from where to get the food? What would be the right process to get the food? When we talk about the nature, we'll look at it in detail. So if I have to produce food, I have to also ensure that the soil becomes richer after I have taken something out of it. When I produce clothes, I have to make sure that the nature does not get depleted. So that kind of mutually fulfilling production processes have to evolve. In fact, we are talking nowadays of sustainability, but let me tell you that sustainability is a small component. It's not only to sustain the production process, but rather to enrich the production process, to enrich the nature. We have to think in those terms. So that kind of system will evolve. And I'll not say that is a very far-fetched idea. We can see there are so many examples across the world where people are practicing and they are evolving such production processes which can be mutually fulfilling for the rest of nature. Similarly, while working for justice, our target would not be only to open the courts and make people file suit and then fight with each other. Our program would be to ensure justice naturally. So the role of a lawyer would not be merely settling the disputes. The role of a lawyer or a person who is working for justice would be to educate the person of the family member so that a feud never arises. This is a being proactive in terms of justice. So we have to start thinking in these systems or dimensions in a proactive manner, rather than thinking in an active or reactive manner. There is a court here in Ghaziabad, in Karkarduma. There is a place called Karkarduma, and it's a family court. And not less than 1,000 cases are filed every month. And most of the cases are to do with either husband-wife relationship or relationship between parents and children for dispute of property, right? Such issues. What is happening when we do not live with justice, when we do not have the right understanding of the feelings in relationship, right? Then there is no mutual happiness and we are suffering. Even though we are living together, we are suffering. So the right role of the justice program would be to educate the person so that one is able to contemplate the right feelings and live accordingly. Similarly, preservation will have a proactive program. We'll take into account whether our rivers are drying or rivers are continuing, right? Now, if you see today, there are many areas, even in our country, which have been declared as dry areas. There is no water available. And there are many areas where drinking water is not available. But this was not the same 50 years back. So who has done this? We have done this. So we are not able to preserve the nature. So we have to make out programs so that we can preserve the air. We can preserve the water. We can preserve the forest. We can preserve the soil. Otherwise, ultimately, we are suffering. Let me tell you that during the time of Green Revolution, production processes that were adopted became somewhat misused. And today, if you look at the state of Punjab, topsoil has become barren in many areas. And there is a train that goes from Punjab to Rajasthan, and that train is called as cancer train, because so much of insecticide, pesticide was used to produce that people start getting cancer, and a particular train is there which carries the cancer patients from Punjab to Rajasthan because there is a cancer hospital in Rajasthan. So we have to look into these things. Also, while for exchanging, we have to see whether our exchange is focused at mutual fulfillment or it is only focused at extracting the maximum from the other. So there can be three modes of exchange. One mode could be take and take. The other mode could be take and give. The third mode could be give and give. So give and give is something where I try to give to the other, that also tries to give me, and then both of us get fulfilled. So I'll give an example. Let us say there's a dispute in the property, dispute of property in the family, and there are two brothers and they file a suit. And they fight with each other for 20 years. And after 20 years, after investing so much on this court cases, it is decided both will get half and half, right? But by that time, so much of resource has already been wasted. The other scenario could be one brother says that, okay, you take the maximum, I'm happy with this. The other person is also able to say that, okay, you take the maximum, I'm happy with it. And they happily share the resources. In fact, even they can live with the resources together on the same availability of resources. So we have to see what mode of exchange is naturally acceptable to us, right? Can it be mutually fulfilling, right? And is it the same today? So we have to again see proactively what we can do to make the exchange process mutually fulfilling. Similarly, the storage process mutually fulfilling. We saw that there is no dearth of production of food across the world, but the distribution is not proper. And distribution is something to do with relationship. So if storages are such that food is being rotten in some warehouse or store and some people are dying of hunger, then certainly our storage system is not proper. So we have to think in that term, how to make the storage system proper. So education, if you see, we discussed it already, to develop the right understanding of the harmony at all levels of our being, from self to the entire existence. And sanskar would mean the commitment, the preparation, and the practice of living. So here, we all have a role to play. So this content is there in front of us. Now we have to see how we can develop the commitment in the faculty, in the management, in the staff, also in the student, because ultimately when we feel committed, then only the students will feel committed. And how we can prepare the students, right? And how we can evolve practices of living in harmony in the institution. So this preparation includes learning the skills and technology for living in harmony at all levels, from self to the entire existence. So we can see now clearly that technology is a small component of this preparation. It is not the complete part. That commitment, that preparation is of course required. And with that commitment and preparation only, these skills will be utilized. Otherwise, if you go on developing technological skills and the right understanding is not there, the commitment to live with right understanding is not there, then the skills will be misused largely. And this is something that we can see in the society today. So education means developing the right understanding. Sanskar means the commitment and preparation and practice for living with right understanding. And the preparation includes learning the right skills and technology. The development of the competence to live with definite human conduct will lead from discipline to self-discipline. So right understanding, that is wisdom or clarity about what to do as a human being in oneself at the level of family, society, nature. This is something that we are exploring in this workshop. And once we have the right understanding, then only we are able to have the right feeling, so that we have the capacity to live with relationship with other human being. And then through this, we can choose the right skills for prosperity. So here also, for the student, the first thing that is required is to build up the capacity to identify the right need for physical facility. What is needed, what is not needed. If you try to see the things that we are using today and try to make out whether the commodity that I have in my house, is it for nurturing the body or protecting the body or right utilizing the body or otherwise, we can find so many things which are otherwise not fulfilling any of the three purposes. So this capacity to identify the need has to be developed, and then the skills and practice for sustainable production of more than what is required has to be developed by using cyclic and mutually enriching process. We'll discuss about this when we talk about the nature, so that this feeling of prosperity can be ensured. Okay, before this, if there is any question, I can take one question. Dr. Femina. Are you able to hear me, Dr. Tamil?
Sir, good afternoon, sir. I thought education and sanskar are one and the same. Is it one and the same or different, sir? As you said, this is the sanskar includes commitment, preparation, practice for right living.
Yeah. So, ma'am, when you have the right understanding in you, then a natural outcome is the sanskar, the commitment and the preparation. But when we are educating the child, we'll talk about the right understanding. At the same time, we will evolve programs to develop the practices and preparation. So, for example, we're teaching this course in the class also. No? So, we can deliver this content, let us in two lectures. And then we can have a tutorial session where we can allow the students to self-explore. And once they are able to see that, okay, they can ensure the fulfillment of need through mutually fulfilling production process, then we can have such labs where mutually fulfilling production process can be applied, can be experimented with, right? So we have to develop such labs, such workshops. We have to let them go to the field, do internship there. So those kinds of practices have to evolve, so that while getting educated, while exploring the right understanding content, the child is also able to validate in living. Yes, and this is something that we have been doing, only the focus has to be shifted. Presently, our focus is on skills. You know?
Yes, sir.
To shift to right understanding.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Right, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question? Dr. Uma Rani? Okay. Dr. Uthai Kumar? Fine. So I'll proceed. Okay. Dr. Uma Rani, I can take one question from you. Ma'am, you are able to hear me? Your mic is unmuted.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. I'm Dr. Uma Rani, Meenakshi Sundararajan Engineering College. I have two questions to ask you. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
This is not related to the present explanation what you are giving. Mm-hmm. But I understand for the 3 days workshop, if I am correct, human values on the basis of self and body is covered so far. But do you have an intention of covering human values on the basis of mind and soul? I personally feel mind is also related to human values.
What we can do, ma'am, when we have the evening session, no, do come up with this question, we'll address it. You know, presently, okay. We are taking the question directly.
I personally feel that mind is also contributing to human values, like body and self.
Right, ma'am. So we'll understand what mind is. In the evening session, we'll talk about it, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. Now, we'll explore how does the education take place naturally in a family. So if you look at the process of development, you know, in an environment of relationship in the family, so the child starts by imitating. So imitation would mean just copying. So the way you speak, the way you sit, the way you walk, you know, the way you do small things, switching on the light. So if you look at the very small stage, up to 3 years or 3.5 years, this kind of stage is visible, imitation. Then slowly the child's body is also growing, the brain in the body is also growing, you know, and the imagination is also growing. So the next stage that comes is the stage of following. So following means that the child is able to add some imagination to it. So the child observes how you are making the chapatis, and the child starts learning how to make the chapatis, how you open your laptop and turn on some file, right? So the child is able to observe and, you know, do a set of exercises. So here what is happening, imitation is just copying one single step. In following, a set of, you know, steps is going to be followed. So we can observe these things in our family also, how the child imitates, how the child follows. By this time, maybe the child has reached the age of 5 to 6 years. And the next stage is the stage of obedience. So when you ask the child to get something for you, you ask the child to get water for you, you know, or do a certain task in the house, the child is able to do it. And then the child's imagination further grows and he enters the stage of discipline. So discipline means that a proper order can be imagined by the child. So for example, you are not in the house and you tell your child that, okay, I will not be there, you know, and uncle might come and you just receive him, you know, and hear from him what he wants to say. So now when you say receive uncle, then the child is able to imagine what receiving means. So when the bell rings, he will go and open the door, then he will say, you know, namaste or hello, and then he will make him sit, bring water for him, you know, tell him that you are not available at home and what task is there to be done. And then finally, when he's leaving, he again say hello, you know, or namaste and goodbye, and this person, you know, will leave, and then he'll close the door. Now set of instructions is there, which the child is able to, you know, execute. So that is the stage of discipline. Now, if you look at this stage, by this time, the child has also gone to school. And till it was only a following stage, the child was only observing you. But by the time the child enters this age, you know, let's say the age of 8 or 9 years, the child is going to school and he has two instructors. One is the parent and the other is a school teacher. Now, if the parent is also having the right understanding, the teacher also has the right understanding, right? Then the student verifies, the child verifies what is right, what is not right. And since there is a family, there is an environment or relationship in the family, there is an environment or relationship in the school, and right understanding is being focused as the first priority in the school as well as in the family, the child self-verifies and finds that, yes, this is the right way to live. This is the way I can live with happiness. I can live with prosperity and continuity. And then the child enters a stage of self-discipline, right? And then as the child grows, so self-discipline comes at the stage of, let us say, 10 or 11 years. And as the child grows, he becomes a teenager, right? And then with a self-confidence, he proceeds in life. He gets educated formally outside, right? He goes to the university by that time. He gets on a job. Now, sometime later, he has a family on his own. And through procreation, he's able to generate another generation. And that self-confidence that he is enjoying within himself gets transferred to the next generation, right? So this is something that will naturally follow when we have the right understanding and right feeling. Families living with this kind of understanding and feeling, you know, education having this kind of thing as the focus. So this will very naturally follow, you know, in the child. So every next generation is more developed that way, isn't it? So we have harmony within, we have harmony in the family, we have harmony in the society, you know, and then the society gets organized in a particular way with so much, you know, of level of competence in every individual. So this is the state which is desirable. This is the, you know, way it has to be, which is naturally acceptable to us. But what is happening today, if you see, now the child at the stage of imitation is able to see that there is always quarrel going on in the family. I'm not saying always, but there is quarrel going on in the family, you know, there are some disputes or something, right? So right from the stage of imitation, you know, the kind of language that we are speaking in the family, the child starts imitating, right? The way we shut the door loudly, the child starts imitating. And then comes the stage of following, and then the imagination further grows, right? And the kind of wrong things that we do in the family, the child starts following. And when you now ask the child to obey you, the child already has some kind of, you know, reaction within for the parent, and obedience is not to be seen. So what you do, you try to discipline the child by pressure, by force, by ordering, right? And by this time, this child has gone to the school also. So the child is observing your conduct as well as the conduct of the teacher. Now the teacher, you know, is appearing in a particular manner because the teacher is there in front of the child only for limited hours. The teacher may also be facing a similar kind of situation in the family, but the interaction that the child has is very limited. So somewhat this child has two choices to make between the parent and the teacher. And many a times he finds that the teacher is, you know, better than the parent. So when you ask the child to do certain thing in a certain manner, he will say that, no, my teacher says like this and I will not do like what you are saying. So when the child enters this kind of phase and tries to verify within oneself, right, and finds that what you are doing is not the right thing to do, you know, you are living wrongly, then the child enters a stage of arbitrariness, what is called as manmani. Now he tries to do, you know, according to his own will and not listen to you. You try to make him obey and he does not obey, right? So what you do domination. You try to dominate over the child. I am your father, you know, you have to do what I am saying, you know, I am feeding you, I am doing this for you, right? Otherwise this will happen to you. So there is a domination coming from the parents and the child is, you know, trying to be arbitrary. But since the child's body is small and he does not have, you know, enough resources, so the child is somewhat obeying you, but within himself he's carrying a feeling of opposition. Within himself, the child is carrying a feeling of opposition for the parents. So this is something like a reaction inside, you know, the feeling of opposition that is going on. Now, after a certain stage, when the child has entered the teenage, he has friends also around. He's entering into the university, right? And the friend also is facing a similar kind of situation. And he is sharing his state of family with you, with the child. And then through these sharings, the child gets some courage and he starts revolting. You know, when you say something wrong, the child is revolting to you or disobeying, right? Or doing something untoward. And you are not able to see what has happened. And you feel like that the child has got spoiled through his friends, right? So you blame the friends of the child. And in the friend's house also, they are blaming your child because there also a similar situation is arising. Now, by this time, the child, you know, is getting educated and getting into a position when he can start earning after some time. And by the time he starts earning, there's a stage of struggle in the family. Two generations are struggling with each other. Now, the child has his own package, you know, he's earning. So he will say that which channel to observe and which not to observe, you know, what to do and what not to do. So there's a stage of struggle in the family. And the child is also interacting with the society. And after this, if you see, marriage takes place. Now what happens in the marriage place? So the spouse is there. Let's say if you're talking about a boy, the girl comes to the house. There is already a phase of struggle in the family, between two generations. Now this girl comes in and then the girl starts saying that, okay, you are right. She tells the boy that you are right. Your parents are wrong. Right. And then a feud starts in the family. Right. Then the parents would call the relatives and invite them to educate the child, to make him right. Right. Now, some of the relatives will take the side of the child. Some of the relatives will take the child of the side of the parents. And then the families get divided. And then when this situation arises, the child would tell the relatives that go and take care of your own family first. A similar situation is there. And this is something like a war kind of situation. So if you look at the condition of society today, when we are saying that the young generation is not behaving appropriately, it is not by dint of only the arbitrariness in the child. It is something that we have done as an inculcation since childhood. If you are not giving the right kind of education, the child started imitating you. The child started following you, obeying you, but still you are not able to verify that you are living the right way. And that's why the child enter into this kind of phase, this kind of revolting and struggle phase, and a war has arisen. Now what happens sometimes later? So this child will also become a parent. Now he has a child of his own. And since there is already a struggle going on in the family, the third generation that comes, goes through the same path, this imitation following. And he's not able to value his parent because he's not able to observe that he's living the right way with happiness and prosperity, with mutual fulfillment. And the same thing will appear generation by generation, right? And then the parents would say that, okay, now you are able to see the reality when you are yourself a parent. So if you look at the society today, it is somewhat like this, And we have to observe whether this kind of thing is happening in our family or not. And every next generation may be less developed, in more contradictions within, in more opposition with family, more struggle in the society, more conflict with the nature and existence. So this is something that is quite perceivable today, something that we can see in the society. But this is not just that has come up, in a moment. It is all by dint of what we have done since childhood. So that's why before becoming a parent, we have to have this right understanding so that we are able to give the right kind of environment in the family. So one possibility is this, something written on the left-hand side, which is an environment of relationship with parents and teachers, having the right understanding and right feeling. And the second possibility is this, environmental domination with parents and teachers lacking right understanding and right feeling. We'll just find out, I am asking one question for you to self-explore. In the meantime, I can take some questions. So are we making effort for a humane society, clearly identified goals, or managing in the present society? In the meantime, if there is some question pertaining the content that I was discussing right now, we can take up. So Dr. Kalai Veni, any sharing from you, ma'am? Yeah.
Sir, I should appreciate the process of development. It is absolutely right, sir. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Listening to you.
Yeah. Hello, sir, if the child is self-disciplined and it's having self-confidence, when grown up, they are self-made. We don't worry much about them and they will settle easily in the society.
Yeah.
So we, the parents and teachers, should be the role model for them.
Yeah. But this is not happening rightly,
Yeah.
What is happening is something right inside. Yeah.
For this, the right understanding and right feeling is very, very important for every individual. That I want
right,
to register here, sir.
Right, ma'am. Dr. Karthikeyan? Okay, I think. Okay, Dr. Umarani? Okay, Dr. Gopal Krishnan?
Hello, sir. Good morning. Actually, the present generation is different from the what we are before. We used to give respect to the teachers and the elders, but the present generation is they are having good ideas, but they are not giving the respect to the teachers or whatever, so on. What is
so that's why we are discussing that, how is this happening? So it is not just that the generation has to be blamed. If we are not having the right understanding, then we are not giving the right kind of environment to the child since childhood. And that's why the child is emerging into an adult, which is not having the right understanding.
Yeah, but the generation is, they are having good knowledge and everything, but they are not listening to the elders. What we are doing before.
They are more informed. The information is so easily available now. They are more informed, but they are not having the right understanding because the parents themselves did not have the right understanding. So that by imitating, following and obeying them, the children would have naturally inculcated the right kind of thing in them. So we have to look at ourselves first.
Sir, no, before we used to listen patiently. Now the people, younger generation, they are not having any patience to listen what we are saying.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, sir. We are not able to validate mutual happiness, mutual prosperity in our life. Second thing that has happened, the rationality has gone up. The students or the children are now asking more questions. Earlier, we did not used to ask our parents so many questions. The children are asking. And if you do not have the right answer to the questions, then of course the child is going to enter into a phase of arbitrariness. So you have to first find out whether you are able to give the right answer to the question of the child or not.
Yes, sir. Now the younger generation having the more technology development, example Google and other things, we don't have such a facilities in the our time.
Yeah, but the issue to understand is why is the child moving towards technology? Why not listening to you?
Yeah.
So somewhere the child is not able to find that validation in you that you will give him the right kind of guidance.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. So nice if you are able to see that we are making effort for a humane society with clearly identified goals. But if we are just trying to manage the society, then we have to think sincerely what to do. So if this is the state which is mentioned on the bottom, then we have to make a transformation, so that through human education, the next generation has improved in terms of understanding, in terms of feeling. And the human education can ensure the personal transformation in the child, so that it can enable a societal transformation. So that generation by generation, we have human beings evolving with human consciousness, which are able to participate in a humane society. And so that this family-based society having common goal gets realized in the society. Now, when you go to work for this, then the scope is from family order to the world family order, right? So let us say in a family, there are 10 people. When three generations are living together, we can approximate the size of the family to 10. And then we have a family cluster with 10 square people and going so on, we can have a vision for the world family having 10 to the power 10 people. Even today there are 778 crores people, right? But going by this way, we can have a program where we can have this sustainable, or let us say a program for mutual happiness and mutual prosperity for all at the world family level. So this is the scope when we start working with this kind of understanding and work on all these five dimensions. So one assignment for today would be like, what is the common goal of the organization you belong to? You can take it as something for self-reflection. And how does it map to the human goal? So let us look into the goal that we have set at the level of organization. And every organization, every college, every institution, university makes a goal. Now let us see whether our goal is in coherence with this human goal. Are we focusing on developing the right understanding in the student? Are we focusing on developing the feeling of prosperity in the student, even for the faculty, even for the management? And how can you and your organization contribute for ensuring the right understanding and right feeling in the neighborhood of the institution? This is another thing we can see. So we can, of course, work within the institution. We can also see what we can do in our neighborhood for this kind of development of the society. So this is something for self-reflection. Start thinking over it, and then we may come out with some programs also. Today evening we'll have one session by one college in this Ghaziabad of Uttar Pradesh, where commendable work has been done, and we listen to the sharing of the Director General of that institute, right? So to sum up, a society is composed of families living together in a relationship of mutual fulfillment, and they have a common goal, which is this, right understanding and right feeling, ensuring happiness in every individual, prosperity in every family, fearlessness, that is trust in the society, and coexistence in nature. And family is the basic unit in the society. That is, society is composed of family, group of families, village family, group of village families, and so on and so forth. And through the participation of every family in the society in the five dimensions of societal systems, the common human goal is fulfilled for all. And then we can have an orderliness from family to the world family, generation after generation. But if you look at the current state, you know, it is largely focused on the assumption that human being is body, happiness is derived primarily from sensual pleasure and feeling from other, and hence accumulation of physical facility, domination, exploitation, that has become the core of socioeconomic systems. Right? So presently we talk about GDP, gross domestic product, and we talk of increasing GDP. But let me tell you that there is a neighboring nation here called Bhutan, which has made the target as GNH, gross national happiness. So let us see whether we can make a shift in the policy at the level of nation also. In place of targeting GDP, can we talk about GNH, how much happiness has grown in the society at large? So there's a lot of us to reflect on, you know,